Have you heard of Qur'anly? It's a habit-building Qur'an app unlike anything you've seen before. The app tracks your verses, pages, time, and hasanat gained as well. I've tried it too. Check out the 7-day free trial and see for yourself. Take your Qur'an reading from inconsistent to finishing it twice a year with the meaning. Download it on the App Store now. Search Qur'anly.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله وحده وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على من لا نبي بعده وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. My beloved brothers and sisters, a productive Muslim is the one who thinks of the future and what is to be done about that future in a positive way. And the future divided into two. That which is immediate in terms of your life in this world, and that which is eternal thereafter, which is the hereafter. If you think about this often, and you ponder over ways of improving yourself, what are you going to do about it in a positive way? So that you can live your life in a way that you won't regret, in a way that you will not feel I should have done more. And thereafter, when your life comes to an end, you arrive in the hereafter in the best state and condition. In a nutshell, the one who can do this will be much more productive as a Muslim than the others. Because it's all about focus. It's all about determination. It's all about hard work. It's all about fighting your laziness. That is a human trait. It's all about knowing what to prioritize. To be productive, there is no room for engaging in the lives of others in a negative way. That's a very important rule. طُوبَى لِمَنْ شَغَلَهُ عَيْبُهُ عَنْ عُيُوبِ النَّاسِ. Give good news of طُوبَى to the one whose own weaknesses occupy him or her from engaging in the weaknesses of others in a negative way. Why do I say in a negative way? It's my duty to remind my children. It's my duty to remind others. It's my duty to do something positive about the negativity that might be around me. So therefore, you may involve in the life of others on condition that it is a positive involvement. I see you doing something bad. Do I backbite? The minute you backbite, your productivity is going to be diminished. Do I slander you? Same applies. Do I make a big deal nowadays in the age of social media? Do I start publicizing the negatives that I have seen without providing solution? Or in order to taint the image of someone or to tarnish their image? If that's the case, you cannot be productive. But to engage in the lives of the same people in a positive way. Number one, productivity in terms of engaging in people's lives in a positive way, when negativity has come from them, when you notice a bad habit, when something unacceptable has happened, number one, you should pray for them. That's the beginning, first step. First step, you pray for them. That shows sincerity. It depicts a level of genuine feeling within your heart. Imagine you see someone doing something, and you say, Ya Allah, help this person. Ah, subhanAllah, you are speaking, right? You are speaking the language of a genuine Muslim, a productive Muslim, because you didn't say, where's the phone? Where's the phone? Let's get it. Let's show the world what's going on. No, that's not what happened. What actually happened was very productive. I saw it and I thought like a Muslim. I said to myself, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, speaks about, Man satara musliman satarahu Allahu. Whoever covers the faults of a believer, Allah will cover their faults in this world and the next. Where is that hadith gone? People don't think about it in the age of social media. What cover? Expose. That's the word today, right? Expose quickly. Are you really concerned about helping community, or do you want to just drop them to a low? Are you excited that there are vices in society, or are you going to be productive enough to contribute by praying to Allah? That's just the first step. It's not the only step, by the way. Not the only step. I pray. I can go home. I can engage in two units of prayer, known as two raka'at of prayer, for the sake of Allah. And I can cry to Allah, "Oh Allah, today I saw something from a sister of mine, from a brother of mine, that was, I don't understand. To me, it was extremely unacceptable. Only you know the conditions of the hearts. Ya Allah, guide them, grant them goodness, help them so it's not repeated. Ya Allah, safeguard the ummah and safeguard me and my family members or my children or whoever else it may be from the same." That was step number one. What's step number two? Step number two, think about how best you can solve or resolve or assist in that matter so that it does not repeat itself. Depending on what authority you have and who you are. If you're a parent, you can deal with it a little bit differently. But a productive parent is never harsh beyond a point. You can be hard, but you don't get to harshness where, especially in today's world, where the children fear you to the degree that they will do whatever you told them not to do behind your back. That's what happens. When you engage your children, when you speak to them, when you tell them, "Listen, this is how it should be." When you penalize them for the wrongdoings that deserve penalization in a way that is not so hard, that is beyond what it is deserving of. You have a naughty corner nowadays. In fact, I can tell you something better than a naughty corner. Take the phone away. It's done. It is worse than caning the child. I've come across, and I did it myself some time back, asking children, "If you do something wrong at home, would you like your father to cane you or to take your phone away?" Guess what? The majority said, "He must just whip us, but leave the phone with us." Imagine. That to me was a response to say, "We're not going to whip you, we're going to take your phone away." And not for so long that they become agitated and they begin to hate you. That was not the aim, but discipline. Each wrongdoing deserves perhaps a correction equivalent to that wrongdoing. And sometimes if it's a mistake, your productivity needs to acknowledge the error of another and forgive it. That's very productive. Why? When people make mistakes, and sometimes even people who acknowledge something that was not necessarily a mistake, they did it intentionally. They acknowledge it, they apologize. It is very productive to consider forgiving them and perhaps forgive them, because obviously, again, depending on what exactly it is. You know, you can't come and tell me someone raped someone else or molested them, and then we come to them and say, "No, just forgive, just forgive." No, 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 no. We need to do something to protect our children, to protect our women, to protect our men and boys and whoever else it may be. And therefore, that will be dealt according to its level. But I'm talking of generally. You look at it, and by forgiving, you have freed your time to concentrate in that which is, or upon that which is far more important. That's what it is. When you have not forgiven, there is a burden that you hold. Allah says in the Quran, وَلَمَنْ صَبَرَ وَغَفَرَ إِنَّ ذَٰلِكَ لَمِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ. The best thing you could do is to bear sabr and to forgive. That does not make you any less of a man. I remember in one of my talks, I said, "Learn to forgive people. Don't worry. Don't hold it." And someone said, "This guy is not a man. Look at him. You're supposed to be a man. Show that you are masculine. Don't forgive people. Punish them. Hit them. Beat." That's not masculine. It is the most masculine thing to forgive. لَيْسَ الشَّدِيدُ بِالسُّرَعَ إِنَّمَا الشَّدِيدُ الَّذِي يَمْلِكُ نَفْسَهُ عِنْدَ الْغَضَبِ. A powerful person is not one who can out-wrestle others, and I can show you how strong I am. A truly powerful person is the one who can control their anger when the tempers are flaring. Similarly, if you can forgive, Allah says it's better for you. Like I said, it depends what it is. It's not just a blanket rule. But generally, You have released a burden from your shoulders that has freed your, what can I call it? A hard drive? What can I call it? An SD card? What else can I say? The memory of your phone? You've deleted that which was unnecessary and deletable so that the speed of your device became better. You were able to put that which was more important and concentrate on something. Otherwise, your mind does become occupied. And your emotions are definitely negative because of that negativity you hold. So, if there is a child who needs admonishment, we admonish them within the limits. That also is goodness. And we need to rectify the issue. Like I was saying, you saw someone, you prayed for them. Now, if you're a speaker like I am, you might want to address the matter at a certain point in a way that does not embarrass the particular person. Productivity is when you know how to address a matter in a common way so that the person is included without feeling that this was only directed at me. You know, when I speak or when I tweet, sometimes people say, "Did you know what was going on in my life?" The answer is, "No, I didn't. I just know generally what's going on in the lives of all of us. We're all human beings. So what I said was connected not to you, to someone, something, sometimes a thought, sometimes a discussion, whatever else it may have been, but you're included in it because the benefit should be broad," again from the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. One day, people came to his wives and asked them questions. And when they heard how productive he was, and he was a prophet of Allah, the one said, "I'm never going to eat meat again." The one says, "I'm going to pray all day." The one says, "I'm going to do this and that," and so on. When the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, came back and he heard about it, the talk or the lecture that he gave, he didn't mention names. To this day, we don't know who it was. I give you another quick example. There was an Arab, Bedouin Arab, who urinated in the masjid. Have you ever heard that story? Have you heard the story? There was a Bedouin Arab who came into Masjid al-Nabawi at one stage, and without knowing he was desperate to use the loo, he went into one corner and he peed. To this day, we don't know his name, subhanallah. But we just know the story. Because the lesson is for everyone. The lesson is more important than individualizing it to the degree of embarrassment to the individual. Subhanallah. What was the point? Imagine calling out your name and saying, "Right, so and so, this is what you did, this is what happened, this is very bad, you shouldn't do it again, and so and so and so." You know what? The proper Islamic way of doing things, if I needed to tell you because I'm a headmaster at a school or I'm a parent, I may tell you individually without embarrassing you. Like the Prophet ﷺ went to this man and told him, "You're not supposed to pee in this masjid. The masjid is not for this. It is for Quran. It is for dhikr, remembrance of Allah. It is for ibadah. It is for salah," and so on. And the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, made him understand what it was all about. The man was so happy. Watch the productivity of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. That man was super excited. Do you know what he said? He says, "Allahumma arhamni warham Muhammadan wala tarham ma'ana ahadan. Oh Allah, have mercy on me. Have mercy on Muhammad, peace be upon him. But besides the two of us, don't have mercy on anyone." Why did he say that? Because the others were shouting at him. That's why. The others were literally shouting at him, scolding him, admonishing him. And he felt it. Imagine, subhanallah. May Allah Almighty grant us a lesson from this beautiful sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So when he got up, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to address the matter of those who visited the home, inquiring about his productivity, he says, "Ma balu aqwamin." What a beautiful terminology in the hadith. He says, what is it with some people? They promise that they will not do this, and one promises he will not marry, and one promises he will not eat meat in one narration, and one promises he will do this and that. We should strike a balance between all matters. That was the message. You have time to pray, you have time to rest. My beloved children, you have time to play, you have time to pray, and you have time to rest. Productivity is when you can manage the amount, or productivity is when you can manage the time that you are going to be on your phone. And we are all guilty, including myself. Why should I take myself out of it? We get carried away on our phones. And sometimes people are talking to us. Productivity is to know when to put your phone aside. May Allah grant me the strength to do that. Say, I mean, at least for me. And may Allah grant all of us the strength to do the same. Ameen. MashaAllah. So, when children play games, you need to know the limit of it. You can't play all day, all night. You've got other things to do. I'm not saying don't play. Productivity is that you do have a portion of time that you play within. But beyond that, come on, control yourself. Tomorrow, inshallah. Look at football. They also stop at 90 minutes, don't they? They do. Imagine if they had to carry on all day, every day. They wouldn't even survive. If it's really getting extremely exciting, they push through to extra time, don't they? How much is it? They tell you 15 minutes, 15 minutes. I think so, right? After that, what happens? They call it a sudden death because now we need to stop. Come on, guys. Now whoever scores this goal, that's what it is. They'll go to penalties after that. There we go. But it stops at a point. What I'm trying to show you is there is a time frame for everything. You cannot pray all day. There are other duties you have. You need to go out and earn. Fighting laziness is one of the keys to productivity. And you have to do it. Nobody is going to be able to do it for you. You have to push yourself in the morning to get up, wash up, cleanse, put on your clothing, and go do what you have to. During the virus, I remember from a psychological perspective, they used to say to us, still get up in the morning, wash up, dress up, put your clothing as though you're going out, but don't go out. That was because we had a virus. Because if you did not do that, what would it result in? You slide into negativity, your body starts, you know, becoming weak, you become lazy, you don't do exercise anymore, so you become accustomed to sitting and lazing around. All that will be negative, and it will result in lack of productivity long term. You become a lazy person. Then you don't want to get up. If there are from amongst us those who feel they don't want to get up in the morning, I plead with you, my brothers, my sisters, try it out. Push yourself to get up. Salatul Fajr is the beginning of the day of a Muslim. Some of us a little bit earlier and some of us a little bit later. A little bit later meaning earlier as in Salatul Tahajjud, and later meaning the beginning of Fajr, or at least before the ending time of Fajr. You get up, you wash up, you fulfill your Salatul Fajr, or you are engaging in dhikr. If, for example, you're not praying due to menstruation or whatever other reason, it may be a valid reason. Then, my brothers, my sisters, what we need to know, when you've started your day on the right foot, your day will be blessed. Your day will be blessed. Allah Almighty has granted us such energy, such goodness, such a beautiful body that it is more sophisticated than any computer. It is more sophisticated than any robot. It gets accustomed to something. I said it in Male the other day, that if you are used to getting up at a certain time, like clockwork, when you set your alarm, automatically your body will wake up 1 minute before that alarm and you'll turn it off. I see people nodding their heads because yes, it's true, it happens. For young people, sometimes they might be too tired. It may not be happening, but put your clock. Don't allow yourself to hit snooze more than twice. Because sometimes we hit snooze, sleep. It becomes a habit. We snoozed about 10 times until everyone is late and everything. Every day you're rushing. Why is it that when we say that we will be there at 8 o'clock, come 8 o'clock, people are still waiting for us? It happens, right? Why? Can you not be there at 5 to 8 for a change? MashaAllah. Can you not be there a few minutes early for a change? We need to not just create an impression, but change the world. Be there on time. And this is why salah is a gift.
Inna salata kanat ala al-mu'minina kitaban mawquta.
How Allah describes it, that salah is prescribed upon the believers at fixed times. One of the benefits of those fixed times is to be able to help you through your day, to lead your life in a timeous fashion, so that you're not late for things. Salah has an expiry. Some of the salahs are shorter in their duration or the duration within which you can fulfill it. Some of them are shorter, some of them are a little bit longer. All that is the plan of Allah. You know, I was sitting, pondering over certain rules. One of them is the ruling of those prayers that are with a recitation that is loud, and those prayers that are with a recitation that is soft. Have you realized during daylight hours, all those prayers, Allah says, fulfill them softly, with a soft tone. The imam in the masjid, soft tone. They are during daylight hours. There is an exception of Jumu'ah and Eid, and perhaps the salawat with an exception. But the five daily prayers generally, the ones during daylight, they are silent. And the ones at night when the sun is down, they are all loud. Have you thought of why? How come? Well, the true reason is Allah decided. That's the true reason. But if you want to ponder over it, you will come to so many different reasons that could have been the case. I give you an example. The hustle and the bustle of the day requires that for productivity, you take a bit of a break. They tell you, let's start off our lesson. We are here at this beautiful college, mashallah. I visited here earlier today and I met with some of our young boys and girls and the scholars and the learners, mashallah, tabarakallah. I tell you, you have a subject, one period, and after that, another one, perhaps maybe a third one, but you have a break. You have a break of 15 minutes, 20 minutes. You go out, you have a bite something. Maybe you might want to do something, freshen up a little bit, or just go and chill, relax. And then what happens? You come back after that and you have another three or four lessons and then you go home. What's that all about? Why the break? Because it is better for your productivity to break from time to time when you are concentrating on something. Allah Almighty Himself makes you break at a certain point. Because for Salat al-Dhuhr, you have to break anyway. Even if you're fasting. It's not a lunch break anymore, it's a prayer break. That's what happens. Why? Because Allah's made us such that you will come back energized. Now the hustle and the bustle, everyone was talking, everyone else is speaking, and whatever was there was there. The traffic is moving, the movement is happening, the sun is shining, the plants are photosynthesizing. And here you are when it's time for the prayer during the daylight hours. Allahu Akbar. Dead silence. Dead silence. Imagine how you are being recharged and you're concentrating in absolute silence. And you're not upset, you're not angry. It can't be bothering you because it's silent. It cannot be bothering you at all. It's silent. During the hustle and the bustle of the rest of the creation's noise, the Almighty is telling you, you be silent when you stand in front of me at that time. And then, when everyone is supposed to now go back, recline and so on, early morning prayer, Fajr, you got up, what do you do? At a time when you're not supposed to be disturbing the rest of the people. In fact, for Salatul Fajr, it is supposed to be allowed in Jama'ah. So you come up and you know what? The Imam wakes you up. That's the beginning of my day. And you're reading. It sounds beautiful, loud. It's in my ears, melodious, amazing verses. Certain surahs are preferred in Salatul Fajr, for example. And I'm just listening to them. And that's the beginning of my day. I've got a beautiful message. And now I start my day after that. And then when I come back from work, for example, my Dhuhr and Asr is already done. It was silent. The Maghrib is short, but loud. Notice it's short, but loud. The Isha is a little bit longer. And which is the longest of the prayers? The Fajr. I'm sure you're aware of the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. All this is magnificently decided by Allah. You're a Muslim. Understand the plan of the Maker. The one who prays five times a day has a unique life of productivity that you cannot imagine. And when I speak of productivity, I'm talking of holistic productivity, not just for this worldly life. My brothers, my sisters, many from amongst us, we are very productive, but only for one side. We've forgotten that there is another side, the eternal side of it, the akhirah, the future, the hereafter. And this is why I say, we get up for school at 7 o'clock, but we could not get up an hour earlier for Allah. So what is the productivity? Subhanallah. The productivity is that we need to maintain a balance between the two. And make sure that you do your best. Like I said earlier, if a person is engaging in the life of another person negatively, they cannot be productive because they are already occupied. You know, when the Prophet ﷺ was making dua against an enemy, he used to say, "Oh Allah, occupy them with themselves." That's what he used to say. "Oh Allah, occupy them with themselves. Allahumma ashghilhu bi nafsihi aw ashghilhum bi anfusihim." Oh Allah, occupy them with themselves. Why? So there won't be any productivity. They will lose. Imagine making dua in the case of those who used to plot against the Muslims. Allah is saying, or the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is saying, "Oh Allah, rather than them occupying themselves negatively with us, let them be occupied with themselves." And that's what would happen. They start crumbling, they start having their own issues, and now they are occupied. The same happens with us. When you would like to achieve something in life, understand, shrug off anything that's holding you down. When you want to fly, you need to be like a bird. You need to know the weight. You need to know how to flap your wings. You need to know what will bog you down. You need to know what is dangerous. And you need to stay away from it. You need to know what is beneficial. And you need to have it. And then you fly and see where you go. See where you go. May Allah Almighty strengthen us. So, it is our duty to help one another, to lift one another up. If you think that you are the only one who is supposed to have achieved and everyone else should not have achieved, that is short-lived. It will live with you and it will die with you. And you will not leave behind a legacy because you did not include others in what you've achieved. But the minute you realize I need to share what I have with a maximum number of people so that perhaps they might excel beyond me and assist humanity to take this thing to some other level, that's when you are much more productive. How many of us have witnessed people who have businesses? The day they died, the business died with them because they did not even teach their kids or let anyone know how they did the business. We saw it happening. But if they had empowered someone, this is why the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, has emphasized teaching. Teach people, reach out to them. Remember, collectiveness is far more important. Teach people, reach out to them, give them, empower them, show them. Be happy when others learn from you. The hadith says you teach someone goodness, you get a reward of everyone who is taught the goodness, even from that person and the next person and the next person. Until the day of judgment, you will continue earning what? A reward. Why? Because you were concerned not just for yourself, for humanity at large. These are all my family members. We're all connected and related. We're all on the earth. Surely if someone is achieving, mashallah, tabarakallah, they would succeed in a greater way if they could, within the boundaries of what is good, share with others. You know what? I just discovered this, Masha. What did you discover? I discovered that in order to eradicate a cancer, for example, you need to have an alkaline diet. Whoa. That was discovered a long time back.
So to fight cancer, you need an alkaline diet. Just an example. Now another person will take that and take it beyond what you just said and perhaps find a solution for that because of what you started. But if you died without having told people, what happens? It died with you. Where's the productivity? What happened? My brothers, my sisters, to care about others. To care about others is one of the cornerstones of productivity. It starts at home. Why does it start at home? Because your family members were chosen by Allah to invest in your children will result in great productivity, not just for yourself, for them too. Subhanallah. You invest in them, you spend time with them, you teach them, you sit with them, you correct them, you commend them. Many of us don't commend. If you'd like to see productivity in a child, even if you're a school teacher, when the child achieves something, tell the child, well done. Very proud of you. MashaAllah. Well done. You've really achieved. Give them an award. Give them a prize. The others will see and want the prize. What did you do? You stirred within them the energy that wants to make them more productive. And what else did you do? The child whom you appreciated will excel beyond because they loved what just happened. Acknowledgement, appreciation. Not just a school teacher, even as a parent. One of the worst things you could do is to promise a child something upon an achievement, and when they achieve, you change your mind. No chance. They say, you become a hafiz, I'll take you for umrah. Why did you make such a big promise when you know you cannot afford it? Right? And when they become hafiz, you say, yeah, I know, but now you're making too many mistakes. Excuses, excuses, right? You don't do that. You break the child. You break the person whom you made a promise to. If you achieve this, I'll give you this. Make it a small thing. Make it a minor thing. If you achieve, for example, if you become a hafiz, we'll go on perhaps a cruise or a tour, something you know you can give. And then when you've given them more, it's going to be a bonus. But when you give them less, you are destroying the productivity in them. They won't believe you. And children need incentives. They are extremely intelligent, but by nature and due to the environment of today, they are more inclined towards playing games and just playing the fool. But when you help them dedicate upon something, and when you show them and teach them and you know how to help them grow, you might need a professional to assist you in that. They will grow beyond your imagination. I'm going to say something. I don't know if it's the right place to say it, but let me say it. I think that the children of today need to start with their school 1 year before what it was. That's what I think. I know they've come up in a lot of countries with grade zero, which is a grade below grade one. I think it might have happened here, or maybe they call it something else. And then prior to that, you have the infant. But the children are so sharp. They are exposed to so many things. They are extremely intelligent because of this exposure that is there. And subhanAllah, they sit sometimes so bored, so bored. Yes, they need to play. Yes, there needs to be a balance. Yes, you should not take the childhood away from that child. But at the same time, they should start learning things. They should start learning things. That's just my take on it. Productivity. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. My brothers, my sisters, I would be failing in my duty if I did not tell you that part of productivity of a Muslim is to spare your time, to declutter somehow and create the time every single day to spend with the word of Allah. What is the word of Allah? The Quran. It is my duty. I should be ashamed of myself as a Muslim if I have not read one verse during the day. Is it too much? How many times did you look at your phone today? How many times have you read WhatsApp messages today? A young boy is saying 10. If the young boy is saying 10, an adult like me, probably 100. Right? So, If you could do that so many times a day, what about the word of Allah once a day, just once? Open that app, inshallah, try. Discipline yourself. Like we said, if you want to achieve and you want to be productive, you need to be disciplined. Discipline. Open the Quran. Read one verse, read its meaning, and then ponder over it. You close it and carry on. You didn't understand something, ask someone, think about it. Next day, another verse. Before you know it, you would have covered so much of ground. And you know what happens? The Quran is such. When you start with one verse a day, it magnetizes you, draws you towards it. It becomes two before you know it, and three and four, and after that it's a page a day. And then it becomes a quarter juz a day and a juz a day. And then you want to listen and so on. In order to be productive as a Muslim, you must spend a portion of time, even if it is a small amount of time, per day with the word of Allah, the Quran. Learn something new about your faith. Learn from those who have learned the faith. Don't learn from the enemies who only want to pick on things and create doubts and confusion out of nothing. Subhanallah. We're living in an age of social media. I remember I delivered a lecture many years ago on a topic. And later on, people fabricated that I said something totally different from what was said. And I was thinking to myself, should I or should I not respond to it? Because when you respond, the response doesn't get to the haters. But they love peddling what they were peddling, and they still peddle it. But the clarification, I realized, they have never invested time in listening to me anyway. Why should I waste my time in responding to them? Why? Leave them. Let them do as they want. That brings me to another very interesting point. Productivity demands that you ignore haters as far as you can. I say as far as you can because you might get to a point where you have to turn and say a few words. But as far as you can, you ignore the haters. Let them say, the naysayers. فَأَعْرِضْ خُذِ الْعَفْوَ وَأْمُرْ بِالْعُرْفِ وَأَعْرِضْ عَنِ الْجَاهِلِينَ Allah says, you know what? Forgive and instruct people to do good and turn away from the ignorant. Turn away. Allah says, وَإِذَا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا A true worshipper of Allah, when the ignorant address them, they just say salam, which means peace, and you walk away. The man swears you, he utters this about you, that about you. You look at him, you give him a broad smile and say peace, and you walk away. He is irritated because he tried to really bog you down. He tried to make your blood boil. And what happened? It didn't boil. Subhanallah. It's not tea, is it? Mashallah. So this is how we are more productive. We are focused. Mashallah, tabarakallah. My brothers and sisters, every opportunity you get given by Allah, seize it. The hadith of Muhammad, peace be upon him, says, and it's regarding productivity, religious productivity as well as worldly, secular productivity, to achieve in both ways. The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, tells us, seize the opportunities before they are no longer. What are the things that he speaks about? He speaks about seizing your young age before you get old. When you're young, you can achieve. Use that to do something. You want to learn how to swim, go and learn. You want to learn how to fish, go and learn. You want to learn how to dive, go and learn. You want to learn, sorry, I mentioned all of those because we're in the Maldives, right? But you want to learn a language, go and learn. You want to learn something, you want to do a subject, do it. Do extra lessons. Now you are young, you are able, you are capable, you will be able to push yourself to the limit. Use your young age before it is overtaken by old age. When you're old, you won't even be able to move. May Allah grant us goodness and make it easy for us at that time. Or if not as dramatic as you won't be able to move, then at least when you're old, you won't be able to do what you're able to do right now. Right? Then what else did he say? He says, use your health before it is overtaken by sickness. Similar. Then he says, use your wealth before it is overtaken by poverty. If you have the means to do something today, do it. You have the means to be charitable, do it. You have the means to build people, to help them, to, for the sake of the Almighty, to empower them, do it. You will find the reward of it will be the blessings in your life and the lives of those around you. It's not just about me. You know, we're in a school, so let me talk again about teachers. We have globally, if you check it out, a shortage of teachers. People don't want to be teachers anymore, or very few want to be teachers. You know why? It's a very difficult profession. It's one of the few professions where your success is determined by the examination result of someone else. Have you thought about it? I'm a teacher. I did my best. But I'm teaching a class of children who failed. What will they say? They will look at me and say, "You failed." Agreed. But it wasn't me. It was them. They were playing. They were not listening. They were this. They were that. They say, "We don't care what it is. You. You are the problem." Right? So who wants that? Who wants to work in a way where they determine my success based on other people's performance? La ilaha illallah. Right? Have you thought of it? That's why people don't want to be a teachers anymore. They say, "No ways. I'd rather look. I'm the top. I'm this. I'm that. And I performed and I achieved results." But I tell you, the blessing of being a teacher is unique. The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, at the time of Badr, when they had captives of war, and the captives of war for the Muslimin were always managed respectfully, he told them, "We will free you." Look at productivity. "We will free you from this captivity if you can teach 10 of our people to read and write." Hey, subhanallah, empowering. Now, I want to pause for a moment because there's something that will make me cry that I'm about to say. I always think about it and it brings a tear to my eyes. For them, what were they going to achieve? They were going to teach someone to read and write. Remember, this is not a directly religious thing. You're learning from a non-Muslim how to read and write, right? That's what it is. And now that you're learning how to read and write, what will they achieve as a result? Freedom. Freedom to do what? You can go now. You're free. You're no longer a captive. Why? Because you taught 10 people how to read and write. That was an instruction from Allah to the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. It happened, he did it, and they were freed. What did they get? They got what is called paradise for them. Because this worldly life, for those mushrikeen of Makkah, who never believed in anything besides the worldly life, they were released back into what they termed paradise. Do as you want, according to them. Don't you think if a Muslim had to teach people how to read and write, Allah would free them too? Don't you think Allah would give them something they also would consider a paradise for them? Don't you think it's worth it? May Allah bless all our teachers. It requires a lot of determination. It requires effort. They are investing in the children. You watch how the dedicated teachers, veterans, look at the children who cannot perform and they make it their project. "This child is my project. The child cannot perform. I promise you, in 2 years, with the help of Allah, this child will be an A star student." Has it not happened? It has happened. I recall teachers who invested in me on all levels. That's why I'm standing here in front of you today. So at times it's not about how much money you're going to earn. It's not, people say, "Why should I go to school? You know what, if it's all about money, I can earn money without going to school." I agree. In principle, what you just said is right. Some of the richest people are the thickest people. Sorry. But it's true. And some of the most intelligent are not necessarily wealthy at all. Right? Allah is showing you. But is it about being the richest? Or do you just need enough to be able to live and enjoy life and worship Allah and be as productive as you can and build others who perhaps will serve in different departments of living, communities and societies, whether it is spiritual, whatever else it may be. I was taught English, I was taught so many other subjects by people who were not Muslim. And a time came when I channeled into this that I am right now, so I'm speaking to you. But it was a lot that happened. So when you are teaching someone, the reward of it, the blessings of it is what is more important. The blessings. You'll find contentment. You'll find your own children will achieve a lot, inshallah. You'll find other goodness. Perhaps Allah gives you good health. Perhaps Allah gives you a respect among society. Perhaps Allah propels you to something you didn't imagine, you wouldn't have got had you not been in that particular position. All this is something beyond wealth. Money cannot buy you respect. People respect money, but they don't necessarily respect you. Driving a flashy car, everyone, hey, salam, salam, salam. They're greeting the vehicle, not you. It's the car. Same guy, come back tomorrow with an old 1960. They won't even look at you, man. Yes. Why? Because that's the world. That's what has happened today. Money cannot buy you certain things. Understand this. That's why when you have it, Allah tells you part of productivity is to initiate projects that will be an endowment for you beyond your death. إِذَا مَاتَ ابْنُ آدَمَ إِنْ قَطَعَ عَنْهُ عَمَلُهُ إِلَّا مِنْ ثَلَاثٍ. Look at productivity again from this hadith. The Prophet ﷺ says, when a person dies, when the son of Adam, meaning a human being, passes away, his deeds, the deeds are cut off from him at that point. Besides three things. What are the three things? One of them is knowledge that they taught. You taught someone, well, you're going to keep on getting a reward even after you die. Allahu Akbar. I didn't really get a salary because I was a teacher. I was a madrasa teacher to make it even worse. Right? I didn't really get a salary. They paid me a few dollars, a few coins. That's it. I couldn't really afford much. But when the man dies or the woman dies, the reward clocks. Anyone who's benefited from you and benefited from the one who benefited from you and benefited from the one who benefited from the one who benefited from you and so on and so on and so on. The reward keeps clocking until when? إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ. Until the day of judgment. That's a صَدَقَةٌ جَارِيَةٌ. It's a charity. Why would the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, tell us that it is such a grand charity that will continue in reward way beyond your death? Because of its importance and because it is sowing the seed of productivity. Bearing in mind that when you were teaching, without you realizing, your teachers all clock the reward. Keep on clocking, and their teachers and their teachers and so on and so on. It's just something magnificent. I sometimes sit and I think of how there is an app. It's called Flight Radar or Flight Aware, right? Where you can open it and you see all the flights. You want to follow a flight, where it is, when it is landing, when it is coming, where it is right now. And so many other details of the aeroplanes and so on. You see all these yellow aeroplanes across the globe in real time. Right? When I sit and think of the reward of a sadaqa jariya, especially when it comes to that which is continuing after your death, and I say to myself, imagine if this was actually shown by these lines and marks, it would be a globe filled with so many of these lines and marks going all over because of you and just for you. That's the reward. Mind-boggling. Mind-boggling. May Allah grant us goodness. Thereafter he says, a person who has taught something, a person who leaves behind a child who is going to pray for them. What did I say earlier? Invest in your children. Teach them. And the first things you teach them about religion. Teach them about Allah. That's the first thing that should start in the life of your child. The reason is, you don't know how long the child is going to live. You don't know how long you're going to live. Yes, the education of the world is important, but that is temporary. Many people do not have the education and they've still made it in life. But not many people have not known about Allah and then made it in the hereafter. In fact, that's not possible. Unless by the mercy of Allah somehow. But subhanallah, you teach them. When you teach them, what will happen? You pass on. They won't say, phew, my father's dead. Now I can quickly claim all his inheritance. What did you just say? Are you okay in your mind? Your father just passed away. Why don't you say, Allah yarhamu? It will help. May Allah have mercy on him. It will help. But rather than that, people are after all other things. Materialism should not take over to that degree. No. You invested in your child, وَلَدٌ صَالِحٌ يَدْعُو لَهُ. And the third thing mentioned, and it's not in the exact order I'm saying it, but it's in the hadith, صَدَقَةٌ جَارِيَةٌ. A sadaqa jariya, where you have given a charity, the benefit of which extends beyond your life. That's called a sadaqatun jariya. I built a school. I drilled a borehole. I planted trees. I put up an endowment, the benefit of which is going to go to the poor, the widows, the orphans, or those who can't afford fees and so on, or to clothe people, whatever else. For as long as your charitable deed that you did in order to benefit long term, for as long as that continues, you clock a reward. Why? Again, it goes back to productivity and nothing else. You thought about the future. What did I say the first sentence today? I said, those who think about the future and do something about it positively. What is the future? Not just for me, all these people, how will they benefit? So what will I do? I'm going to repair this road. I'm going to come up with an initiative. We're going to put up a bridge. We're going to do this. We're going to do that. It might seem like that is just worldly, but I promise you, if people have benefited from it, you will have a reward. Evidence of it is, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, says, whoever planted a tree, every time someone gets shade from the tree, or fruit from the tree, that person gets a reward. Shade from a tree, you get a reward. Who got that shade? Not you, someone else. Other people. Or fruit from a tree. If that's the case, what about a bridge? What about repairing the road? What about a borehole for the public? What about something for people, for everyone and anyone? What about that for animals and so on? Do you think about the future? Do you come up with these ideas? Do you plan 50 years ahead and tell yourself, you know what? I need to do something. Let me sit. Let me think. Let's gather our friends. It's not just about me. The whole reason why we're talking about this topic today is in order for us to be the most successful, both in this world and in the hereafter. That's the reason why we're talking about this. And in order for that to happen, we definitely have to build a relationship with Allah. I've already spoken about Salah. I've already spoken about Quran. And that itself will lead you towards your beautiful dress code, your lovely way of speaking, your beautiful mannerisms, your etiquettes, character, conduct, and so on. All of that in its place. But you also need to care about the future of mankind. You be productive by engaging in projects that will preserve the world for those who are to come. We talk about preservation. That's not my field. But I can tell you from a religious perspective, you would get a reward to ensure that the sea is not contaminated so that the future generations can benefit from it. You would get a reward to ensure that the environment is not contaminated to the degree that the others will not benefit. Rather, we protect it so they can benefit. The thought, the planning, all of that is part of Islam. It's part of the life of a Muslim. Think long term. When we sit and talk today about Muslims in Islam, many times we talk about Ibn Sina. We talk about the people who lived a long time ago. We talk about their achievements. What about my achievements? What about your achievements? What are you going to do? What are you achieving? What have you achieved? We can, we have, we should, we must. But it requires great dedication. My beloved brothers and sisters, I ask Allah Almighty to open our doors. I ask Allah Almighty to open our minds, to help us strike a beautiful balance. The balance between that which is beneficial for the worldly life of ours here and that which is beneficial for the hereafter. And we ask Allah Almighty to help us to be an asset to our family members to begin with, to our societies and communities, to our cities, to our nation, and to humanity at large. May Allah really make us amazing people. We don't have time to bicker. We don't have time to talk to one another in a derogatory way. We don't have time to be belittling one another, being petty. All of that, we need to do away with it. Come on, let's mature ourselves and carry good discussion. Even when disagreeing, this is the fourth time I'm saying it in this country. Even when disagreeing, we need to disagree with respect, because there is a disease nowadays, even amongst religious people. When we disagree, we have to swear, we have to insult, we have to belittle, we have to say some derogatory words. That's the only time we've made our disagreement clear. That's not it. That's not a productive Muslim. That's not the quality of a Muslim at all. You disagree, you can disagree as strongly as you want, but in a mature manner, in a proper fashion. You say, listen, I do not agree with what you've just said, but you know what? I respect you. It's okay. That's your opinion. This is mine. Well, I might say, let's discuss it. We can discuss it without swear words, without raising our voices, without insulting each other, because the minute you do that, you lack productivity. You are going nowhere. It's going to become a match of screaming and swearing and insulting. Whoever can insult louder, they are the winners. I went to Egypt once many years ago. Some of you, I'm sure you might have visited. And the driver who was driving the car, the taxi, he bumped into the guy in front. He came out and he started swearing, and the other guy was swearing, and he swore louder, and that guy was screaming louder, and this guy. And I'm thinking to myself, it's not such a serious bump anyway. I thought maybe they'd call the police. Anyway, 5 minutes of screaming and yelling and this way and that way. Then he jumps into the car and he drives off. I told him, what happened? He said, this is Masr. This is Egypt. He says, nothing happened. I just told him, don't do this again. I said, what is it? I said, whoa. I was quiet. I didn't want to insult him further away or say anything, because the culture at that time was whoever can scream louder won the match. You jump into your car, goodbye. I feel good about myself and I'm gone. Come on. I thought to myself, one day I need to talk about this, man. You don't just do that. Even if you jump out of your vehicle, what happened? Did anyone die? You worried about anyone? You worried about life? Is anyone injured? Does it require any medical assistance due to emergency? No. Then you thank Allah. Now let's look at the vehicles. Okay, how is the damage? Can I move? Can I not move? What to do? You may want to call the traffic police or whatever the law is in the land that happened. And you might want to continue, but do it with respect. No need to get agitated. People get so angry. Accident is called an accident because it is exactly that. It's just an accident. No one bumps into you purposely and they come from the back with their car or their motorbikes and boof, they bump into you and say, sorry, sir. Look at you. Is that what happens? Not at all. Or they say, I just wanted to feel what it felt like to bump into you. You know, you have a nice car, by the way. No one does that. It's called an accident. But have you noticed how when an accident happens, people get angry? Couldn't you see? You have eyes or potatoes? Say, oh, relax. Eyes or potatoes? Can't you see? Can't you think? What were you doing? What were you thinking? It's too late to get upset and angry. Don't get angry. You might want to say, look, this shouldn't happen again. And perhaps you were wrong. They may be penalized. They might pay a fine. And we continue. May Allah Almighty grant us ease. I've spoken for a whole hour. I think I should carry on, right? Should I carry on? MashaAllah, everyone's saying yes. My brothers and sisters in Addu, this is a beautiful place. This crowd has always been a beautiful crowd. I see faces I recognize from the last time, some of them. And others I don't. But MashaAllah, may Allah bless you and grant you growth. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant you development, not just in your city, but even within your hearts, within your connection with Allah. May Allah Almighty bless your nation, and may Allah Almighty take you from strength to strength. Ameen. Aqulu qawli hadha wa sallallahu wa sallama ala nabina Muhammad.